Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to our full new Friday and our last day of the third annual Slow Living Summit. My name is Lori Hanau, and I am the MC for the two plenaries today, and it is such an honor and a joy to be here with all of you. Just let me see a raise of hands if this is your first day. Okay, thank you. And a raise of hands if you're from out of town, out of the Brattleboro region.
Whoa.
Yeah, thank you. And a raise of hands if you're in the Brattleboro community, if you live in the Brattleboro community. So I just want to start with a few announcements. I do want to say, first off, that I'm so appreciative of how respectful everyone has been around time. And I know over the past couple of days, I've asked for our collective energy and support and mindfulness around the flow, the quality of the flow. And I just want to thank you so much for how you've shown up and for your care and how much it makes such a difference. So thank you all very, very much. Secondly, I just want to go over a couple of changes in the program. The Slow Living and Sustainable Aging breakout that was going to take place this afternoon unfortunately has had to be canceled. Joanna was not able to show up today for personal reasons, so that was also listed online, but we just want to make sure that you're aware of that if you're just looking at the paper program. And then that was going to take place in the chill room over at the Marlboro Grad Center. And again, if you're new today, we have Marlboro College, which resides about 20 minutes from here in Marlboro, Vermont, and the Marlboro Grad Center resides right here in town, just across the intersection to the right of the museum. And if you're not sure where that is, anyone out at registration can help you or you can just follow the crowd. Since rain is a certainty for today, we also will have Larkin Bunce's experiential ramble to meet the plants at 1:45. That will now be held indoors at the Marlboro Grad Center in the chill room, which is located upstairs, and will also be posted. That location is posted at the entrance in the Grad Center. So rather than going out to find plants, Larkin is generously bringing them to the session. I also just want to make you aware of the fact that room locations are on page 15 in your program book, plus bathroom strategies. Another point of awareness for us is that in the main lobby, we have a pad and pen. We would so appreciate the collective wisdom of the hall and all of your voices and opinions and wisdom around what does slow living mean to you? Maybe a sharing of some of the ways you practice slow living, and any other questions or insights you may have on slow living. Along with that pad that's out there, there is please look over at the hall information. There's a table out there with a lot of different information on it. And over in the River Garden, where we will be for lunch today, there are sponsor tables and a table for books, so please make sure you check those out too. The River Garden is located just north. We go out of the theater and you turn left and you go up a couple of city blocks, and the River Garden is on the right-hand side, and there are big signs out there. That's where we'll be having lunch. Over in the Marlboro Grad Center, there is a quiet room. When you go into the Grad Center, it's on the first floor, and if you go left and wind around, you'll find it. So if you need any time to just take a few moments for yourself, to rest, to meditate, to take a nap, please don't hesitate to use the room that's there. There is a sign on the door that says the quiet room, and Kelly Fletcher, who's at the front desk, can also guide you. Lastly, I just want to say that the afternoon, the whole day today, I'm so excited about this whole day. This is a really, really wonderful day. We will be closing with our afternoon plenary through the inquiry of what are our next questions that have come out of our time here together today. So I just want to offer, this is going to be very interactive. We're going to have some synergists from the stage, and then also all of us together giving our voices and wisdom for what have we seen in the patterns of this summit, what are some of the gold nuggets that we've gleaned, and what do we think are the next questions coming out of the summit time. So I just want you to be aware of that so you're thinking for yourselves about what you're noticing while you're here, what you're experiencing, in a way that could be shared with the whole group this afternoon. So that is it for announcements. I do want to bring up for a moment Geraldine Wilson, who is on the program committee.
So I wanted to share how grateful I am for the masterful leadership of Martin Langeveld, who has really led the planning of this summit. I was one of 10, 11, 12 people who would show up at periodic meetings that Martin would call. There was a different constellation of us planners at every meeting, and Martin was grateful for whoever came, and he held the timeline of what we needed to be focusing on at any one meeting. He came with questions, he listened, he gleaned the best of our dynamic discussion, and then would carry forth. And in between meetings, I had no idea what was going on, but the next meeting I would come to, everything that needed to be done had been done, and he had the next set of questions for us. So he did an awesome job weaving things together. And Martin, where are you? Here? Did he want to come up and say something? Of your weaving, I would like to present you with a basket.
Oh. Well, thank you. I wasn't expecting that, but good morning and welcome to this final day of the third annual Slow Living Summit. We're sorry about the rain, but you know, strolling of the heifers is about farming, among other things, and so we have to accept it. And all of our weekend events are going to happen, rain or shine. Just a tip, in case you need an umbrella or poncho or any of that stuff, right across the street, Sam's can help you. If you haven't experienced Sam's, you should. And also, just one other quickie announcement is, I'm still looking for anybody who happens to be heading reasonably close to Worcester this afternoon or tonight. We have a guest of the summit who would like a ride over there. It doesn't have one yet. So talk to me if you can help with that. So I'm the guy who's been sending you all those email messages. And so now I want to thank you for responding and being here, for urging your friends and colleagues to come. And you're going to hear from me again. Pretty soon I'm going to email a request that you do an online survey. You can certainly also respond with your thoughts by email, but that kind of feedback is very helpful to us in planning next year's summit, and we appreciate that. And then later on in the fall, you're going to start to hear a little bit about Slow Living 2014, starting with a call for proposals, which this year yielded, you know, most of our workshops and breakout sessions. And so if you have any thoughts in that direction, please look for that. And it'll be on the website also. And be in touch with us if you're interested in presenting in some way next year. Finally, I just want to mention that, as we've said each day, slow is the opposite of fast. And that's why we're using the metaphor of slow. Slow embodies cooperation, respect, sustainability, gratitude, and resilience. But slow living is not just about slow. It's also about living. And so living is an important word there. You know, you can be living, but not living. And so living should be mindful and purposeful, but also celebratory and filled with beauty, joy, and gratitude. And defining what we mean by that, what we mean by living well, you know, is a hard thing, and understanding it, what we mean by a life well lived. And so that question is as relevant today as it was to the ancients, but just as difficult. So let's just keep working at that today. Thank you.
It has been a dream working with Martin. So I am also completely excited about this tone-setting moment. For those of you who are new today, I will say anew that our tone-setting moments will happen at each plenary, this morning's and this afternoon, and they are to support our presence, our capacity for receptivity, and our beauty. So the Sing About Singers, and Judy Davidson will be the jewel of our tone-setting moment this morning. I want to introduce you to Judy Davidson, who will be introducing the singers and then be a part, her own part of the tone-setting moment. So Judy is a retired psychologist and teacher of mindfulness-based stress reduction classes. She's a member of the Sing About and the Women's Chorus. And she says it gives her much joy to sing with this inspiring group of women. In her personal life, Judy and her husband, Jack, are trying to incorporate the many values of slow living into their own lives. 4 years ago, they sold their house on 3 rural acres and downsized to buy a house in Brattleboro with another couple who also wanted to simplify their lives. They subdivided the house into 2 separate units, but are sharing costs for maintaining the exterior. Now Jack can walk to work, they can walk downtown to the movies and events, and their car expenses have decreased significantly. They have an increased sense of community with their new neighbors, potlucks, intergenerational basketball games, and bike rides that include fun lunch destinations. It's been a wonderful change. And it's with respect and joy that I introduce you to Judy Davidson. Please help me in giving her a warm welcome. So here come the Sing About Singers.
The great pleasure of introducing you to Becky Graber, who is our talented and energetic director. Becky, who is also a composer, founded the Women's Chorus in 1996, and it has now grown to about 100 women who get together weekly just to enjoy the experience of singing together in a group. And I have to say that a lot of the joy of our singing comes from Becky herself, who just radiates warmth, humor, and playfulness. So here's Becky to introduce the songs that we're going to be singing this morning.
Thank you very much. We are very happy to be here. We are, because of the hour, required to think about blend and gentleness as we sing this morning. So that's good. We're going to sing 3 songs for you. The first is called A Question of Tempo, and it was written by Joanne Hamill of Boston. And you'll get something special if you are able to understand our words, which depends on us and you. The second song is a folk song from Liberia that, again, I think you will appreciate the words. And the third song, Woyaya, you may be familiar with. It's a song that was composed by the band Osibisa, of South African musicians. And you've perhaps heard, we are going, heaven knows where we are going, but we know within. So we are happy to offer you three songs.
Slow down. Breathe deep. Stay centered and calm. I try, but I can't. I'm thinking of adding a relaxation class into my schedule so I can be more steady, even though I'm adding more. 'Cause when I'm under pressure, I get speedy and tense up, and then ironically, I don't get as much done as I could if I would slow down.
When I'm under pressure, breathe deep
and tense up, and stay centered and calm. I try, but I'm pressured. I am thinking of adding a relaxation class into my schedule so I can be more steady. I get speedy and tense up, and then ironically I don't get as much done as I could if I would slow down. Take time in life, brother, take time in life. You have far away to go. knows how we will get there, but we know we will. It will be hard, we know, and the road will be muddy and rough, but we'll get there.
Oh, we'll get there.
Heaven knows how we will get there, but we know we will.
So I'm Judy Davidson, and I hope that you appreciate the lyrics of the songs that we that Becky chose for us this morning. Aren't they perfect? So I'm going to lead a brief breath meditation this morning to kind of get us centered. But first, I just want to congratulate all of you for taking the time out of your busy schedules to come to the summit and participate here with so many other people. And I hope that the last 2 days have been interesting and stimulating for you, as they have been for me, and that you've met many new people. So now I invite you to just be here now. And to begin this process, I suggest that you sit perhaps a little more upright in your chair, if that's possible, aligning your head and your neck and your back in a straight line, putting your feet flat on the floor, and just feeling yourself supported by the chair, by the back, perhaps by the very earth itself. And if it's comfortable for you, I invite you to close your eyes. But if that's not comfortable, lowering your gaze, focusing at a point in front of you, and perhaps softening your gaze just a bit. And now letting go of the busyness of the morning so far. Letting go of any thoughts, letting go of any planning, just allowing yourself to be right here. Nothing to do, nowhere to go. And beginning to focus on your breath, just the natural rhythm of your breath today. No need to manipulate it or change it in any way. Just focusing on your inhale and your exhale. Breathing in vitality and freshness, and breathing out any unnecessary tightness or tension in your body. Perhaps noticing where in your body you feel the breath most vividly. Perhaps at the very tip of your nostrils, with a flow of air in and out, or perhaps the rising and falling of your chest or your abdomen. Just noticing. And following one full breath from the inhale to the slight pause at the top of the inhale, through the exhale to the pause at the bottom of the inhale. Inhaling, exhaling, and perhaps resting a moment in the pause at the bottom of the exhale, just allowing yourself to let go. And finally, experiment with experiencing your body as a whole body, breathing with your whole body. Perhaps noticing this most at your shoulders, the rising of your shoulders as you breathe in freshness, and the releasing and relaxing as you exhale. So I invite you to open your eyes now and bring this sense of vitality, freshness, and calm to the plenary session, and perhaps experiencing greater awareness and curiosity as we go forward today. But I ask you to remember that any time during the day or in the future when you feel a sense of tenseness, tightness, pressure, stress, you can refresh yourself in this way by simply doing this kind of simple breath exercise. Thank you.
So much, Judy and Becky, and gorgeous Sing About singers. I mean, really, just one more round for them. So heartening, really, really lovely. And so now, transitioning to a new economy. I want to first introduce Chuck Collins, who'll be introducing Gus and Tina. Martin is also suggesting the plenaries have had such depth and liveliness to them that if the group, we were exactly on time, we're just on point, but if it's a lively conversation and we want to have an extra 10 minutes, we have, you know, buffered that in throughout the day. And so, Chuck, I'm gonna leave that up to you, but just to know that, for you to know and for all of us to know together, that if we go a little over, there'll still be enough time for the people leading the breakouts to be able to get to where they need to go and for those breakouts to happen. So we'll see where the energy takes us. So Chuck Collins is a dad, community organizer, and author, and a senior scholar at the Institute for Policy Studies. He coordinates IPS's program on inequality and the common good, and the web portal, inequality.org. He's the author of several books, most recently 99-1, How Wealth Inequality is Wrecking the World and What We Can Do About It. He worked with Warren Buffett, Paul Newman, and Bill Gates on a successful national campaign to keep the estate inheritance tax from being abolished. He is co-author with Bill Gates Sr. of Wealth and Our Commonwealth, Why America Should Tax Accumulated Fortunes. He lives in the Jamaica Plain neighborhood in Boston. That neighborhood has it going on, doesn't it? Really does. And he is very active with their local transition town, the Jamaica Plain New Economy Transition Effort. He also spends time in a little off-the-grid cabin in Guilford, Vermont, just up the road. Please join me in welcoming Chuck Collins.
Good morning. Welcome to this plenary on issues of the transition to community resilience, a transition to a new economy. I'm going to say a few remarks at the beginning and a little bit at the end and kind of be the bread on the sandwich for Gus and Tina. But I also wanted to echo the accolades to Martin Langenfeld, who has been a very can-do ally in helping us with some sessions here. Last October, representatives of about 32 New England communities came together, transition towns and other very local community resilience building efforts, and we had a very dynamic meeting in Boston. And at that meeting, people said, we want to continue to meet, we want to continue to have celebrations together, we want to share our stories with each other. And so we took that away, and the first follow-up meeting, I think it was Claire Wheeler who said, maybe we can find some other event to glob onto so that we could not create our own gathering, but and immediately thought of the Slow Living Summit because there are many transition themes here, and so when we reached out to Martin and the Planning Committee, they were completely can-do. They saw the elegance of doing that. So you may notice that at each of the sessions, there's a workshop that has the name Transition in it, and there's a little flyer, red flyer, out on the table that mentions there were three sessions yesterday, and there are two more sessions today, and a gathering tomorrow after the stroll of all the transition towns and local community resilience efforts. So you're welcome to see that. But so we are very happy to be globed on here at the Slow Living Summit, and I think it's not really a glob. I think it's kind of a nice melting and integration. So huge thanks. And every step of the way, Martin was just, we can do this. This is great. Here's what we need from you. And so thanks. I should mention we're going to glob on a few other places into the future. In July, at the World Fellowship Conference Center in the White Mountains, there's going to be kind of Camp Resilience, an all-family camp from July 7th to July 14th. There's still openings to attend if you'd like. You can come for a day, you can come for the whole week. So check out World Fellowship and the camp that'll be up there. In the fall, there's going to be some other training events. We hope that Rob Hopkins, the founder of the Transition Town Movement from Totnes, England, will be here in New England. It looks like October 3rd, October 4th. So we're going to try to convene a gathering around that. And we also hope to visit Portland, Maine. The folks at the Resilience Hub in Portland have said, hey, we'd love it if you came. And a lot of us would like to see what's going on. Wouldn't you like to know what's going on in Portland, Maine? Right? So we hope to gather there in the fall as well. So you can learn about that at NE Transition, New England Transition, NE Transition. But at that gathering in October, we had people from Belfast, Maine, to New Haven, from the Upper Valley, down to New Jersey. And it was very energizing. And I think part of what brings us here to this session is recognizing the moment that we're in. And I think for those of us who've been here through the summit, it's very powerful. I think for Wednesday night, Jonathan Lash and Bob Repetto talked about the ways in which these extreme inequalities of wealth and power, the climate crisis, have brought us to a new moment. And at the same time, the political system, Washington, D.C., has been primarily captured by a couple thousand global corporations, blocking the process of transition that we really need to go through. And at one of the audience members asked the panel a question on Wednesday night. You've been talking about how these changes take generations, and yet we don't sort of have that amount of time. And then I think yesterday morning, Francis Moore LePage kind of came back to us and said, look, we can change rapidly. We can change how we think. We can rewire our hearts and our brains and our ways of interacting with each other and rapidly change in a way that will help us make this transition. And Judy Wicks talked with us about building businesses as agents of change in a transition to a new economy. This session, I hope, will pick up that conversation. How do we make the transition to resilient communities? How do we make the shift from the old dinosaur economy, fossil fuel driven, a model of growth that's clearly unsustainable, to something that's totally different, more equitable, and in harmony with the earth? So our hope is that in this conversation we will look at what are the things we can do, both at a larger national level and at a very local community level, to sort of move that transition along. Here's what we know. We are in deep shift. As Charles Eisenstein told us last year here, we are between two worlds. We are between the old world and the old story, the age of separation, the disconnection of ourselves from one another, the disconnection of ourselves from our nature and natural being. And we are in this bridge to a new story, a story of connection, gratitude, abundance, seeing the commons around us and all that sustains life. Francis talked about how our brains are actually, what was her word, plasticity or something like that? That our brains have this amazing capacity to change and rewire, and that we are capable of transformation. We're capable of transformation ourselves and bringing that into our communities. And I like to think of the slow living movement as one of the ways that we give ourselves the space to do that rewiring and retransformation and living ourselves into the new story. But we know we can't do this alone. It is done in relationship. It is done in relationship with nature and with other people, and it is done in our communities. And this is why I'm excited that both Gus Speth and Tina Clark are here to help us think about how we're going to make this transition. We've purposely brought them together because they are going to bring out some different themes and pieces of what's necessary. First, Gus Speth is going to reflect with us on how system change can come to the United States, how it already is in some ways coming to the United States and the planet. I've often heard Gus give an acupressure metaphor. He'll say, there's many important things that we can do out there, paths to transformation. But what are the pressure points, right? You know, you've got that back spasm, and somebody goes, right here, boop, and all of a sudden, right? Something shifts. They were massaging your hand, but until they hit that pressure point, boom, something shifted. Well, what are the pressure points? What are the places where we can, together, through campaigning and through other efforts, make a difference? For instance, a carbon tax. Phased in, putting a price on carbon could be one of those pressure points, could lead to rapid shifts in all kinds of things, technology and flows of capital and investment. Gus Speth is on the faculty of the Vermont Law School. Prior to that, for a decade, he was the dean of the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies. But before that, he is really one of the pioneers of the modern environmental movement. He's a co-founder of the Natural Resource Defense Council. He is the founder of the president of the World Resource Institute, where our two Wednesday night speakers both worked. But in the last 4 years, I have seen Gus also make this migration to a sense of focus on this transition to this new economy. And anything really that has the name new economy in it, now Gus is sort of involved in some way. He's on the board, president of the New Economics Institute, the New Economy Working Group, and a number of those efforts. I want to lift up two recent books of his, The Bridge at the Edge of the World, Capitalism, the Environment, and Crossing from Crisis to Sustainability, and his most recent book. And both these books are at the river. We'll be at lunch. Everybody's books has them. America the Possible, Manifesto for a New Economy. Please give a Slow Living Summit welcome to Gus Speth.
Thank you, Chuck, and it's a great honor to be here with you. I appreciate this invitation very much, and pleasure to be on the panel with Tina, whom I've heard before. All the groups that Chuck mentioned did better after I left. I had some thoughts for you, but when Judy was talking, I let them go. I've been struggling to find them again. It's not hard for someone who grew up in the pre-air conditioned South to move slowly, or speak slowly, for that matter. So I think, as Chuck said, we know that the country today isn't delivering socially, environmentally, politically, economically for us. And when we have encompassing problems across such a broad spectrum, it can't be for small reasons. We have encompassing problems because we live and work in a system of political economy that's wired, that's programmed for certain priorities and not others. And so let's define this new economy that we want in contrast to the political economy that we have today. We can define the new economy that we want as one where the true and actual purposes of economic life are to sustain and to strengthen people, place, and planet, and no longer to give overwhelming priority to profit and product, as in gross domestic, and power, the projection of international power. And, you know, if we take that definition, if you will, of the economy that we want and should be striving for, the question comes up, how do we transition to it? And I haven't been able to find a better way to describe this mega transition, this daunting and very large transition, except by doing the following. And that is to first identify what are the features of the current system that are giving rise to the problems. And secondly, how do we change those features into something, into a set of arrangements and policies and institutions that really do prioritize people, place, and planet. And the best way to do that, I think, is to identify a set of sub-transitions, so to speak, transformations that undermine these current structures and replace them with new structures. And when we do it that way, it becomes a more tangible and workable project. For example, I want to list some of these now, and these transitions that I think are part of this overall meta-transition. First, in economic growth, we need to move from our current growth fetish to a post-growth society, from focusing on mere GDP growth to concentrating on growth of human welfare and democratically determined priorities. A transition in the market, from this market fundamentalism and this near laissez-faire that we have, to powerful market governance in the public interest, from dishonest prices to honest ones, from commodification to reclaiming the commons. The transition in the corporation, from shareholder primacy to stakeholder primacy, from mainly one ownership and motivational model to alternative business models, and the democratization of capital and wealth, co-ops. The transition in money and finance, from Wall Street to Main Street, from money created almost all by bank debt to money created by government, as Lincoln would have it. A transformation in social conditions, from economic insecurity to real security, as Franklin Roosevelt urged strongly in his second, his final State of the Union address in his second Bill of Rights, from these vast inequities that we have today to fundamental fairness. In indicators, from GDP, that's grossly distorted picture, to accurate measures of social and environmental conditions and the quality of life. In our consumerism and our affluenza, to move from that to sufficiency and mindful consumption, and from more to enough. In our communities, where many of you are currently engaged, from runaway enterprises and throwaway communities to vital local economies, from social rootlessness to rootedness and solidarity at the community level. In our dominant cultural values, from having to being, from getting to getting, from richer to better, from separate to connected, from apart from nature to part of nature, from transcendent to interdependent, from near term to long term. In our politics, from weak democracy to strong, from this creeping corporatocracy and plutocracy that Chuck mentioned to true popular sovereignty. And in foreign policy and the military, from this runaway American exceptionalism to America as normal nation, from hard power to soft, from military prowess to real security. I think those dimensions of change, when you think about them as part of the overall picture, we can see that there are lots of people working on these issues now in each of these areas. And it's possible to develop metrics in each of these areas to gauge how far along we actually are in the various areas towards the transition to a new economy. I haven't done that yet, but it would be possible. So then we get to the question that Chuck was getting at. What forces might actually drive these transitions? What cross-cutting things need to happen that we need to do if we're going to drive change in these areas? Put a little differently, how can system change actually come to America? And I have this little schema that I call the, with apologies to Buddhism, the Eightfold Way. Because there are eight areas where I think we need to concentrate our efforts to think about how far we are along in these various areas and where we need to build. The first area is that we really need to bring people to see that this is a systemic problem and it's only going to be solved by systemic deep changes. Incremental reforms are great. We've got to do something about the climate issue that Chuck mentioned right away before we'll, you know, get to the deeper changes that are needed. But we need people to see that it's a system that's failing us across this broad front, and to appreciate that we need to complement incremental reform with deep transformative changes in the political economy. The second area are crises. We know that crises can point to underlying failure. They can make people think. They can raise difficult questions. They send people searching for answers. If they're serious enough crises, they can delegitimize the whole system or some important parts of it, like banking. And our country has lost a lot of resiliency, I think, and coping capacity, and there will be more crises, environmental, economic, and otherwise, but they'll only move things in the right direction if we're prepared for them. The third area, pressure point, acupuncture point, and this is critical, is what I call progressive fusion. The progressive communities in the U.S. today are badly fragmented, siloed, you know this. What we desperately need is a fusion, a coming together of all the progressive forces in 30-some-odd communities, or issue areas, so that we have a unified progressive identity, concerted efforts to institutionalize coordination on a regular basis, not just for particular campaigns, a commitment to create a powerful and unified movement on the ground, and a common infrastructure that's capable of formulating clear policy objectives, strategic messages, and coordinating joint action. We are very far from that today among progressives, although there are positive signs. Indeed, in all of these areas that I'll mention, there are positive signs. A fourth area that we need to concentrate on that could drive deeper change is to come together on a shared vision of a positive future. When I was writing America the Possible, I didn't find nearly enough on this. I thought there would be a lot more. This depiction of a new American dream, if you will. And I think, you know, both Bill Moyers and others have written about the power of narrative, of story, in getting us to a bright future. And we need a much stronger and more widely shared vision of where we want to go, or we're unlikely to get there. That's also essential to knowing how far along we are, right? If we have a clear vision of where we want to go, it'll be a lot easier to know how close we are to it. The fifth area is where a lot of you are already engaged, and thank you for it. And that is bringing the future into the present in our communities. And that's what is happening at this summit. You know, building the future from the ground up in an area, where a neighborhood, a community, a town, a city. We need transition towns. We need intentional communities. We need all kinds of community revitalization, new types of corporations that are rooted, local living economies. And the people that are doing these things have made a transition that has got to accompany all these transitions. And that is a transition in values, in consciousness, beyond the materialism, the anthropocentrism, the individualism, the contemporocentrism that so badly infects us today. The sixth transition is a transition in leadership. When crises come, we need transformative leadership, not just transactional leadership. And I know that many of us have, in effect, what some of us have been saying is that we wish our president was more of a transformative leader, but getting some of the transactional things done would be nice too. I mentioned that this leadership is often most powerful when it tells a story, when it has a narrative that relates past and present and the future that we want. And let me quote Bill Moyers here. I mentioned a moment ago, he's written that America needs a different story. So let me say what I think up front. The leaders and thinkers and activists who honestly tell that story and speak passionately to the moral and religious values it puts into play will be the first political generation since the New Deal to win back power for the people. The seventh area that could drive transformative change is building a grassroots movement and a real commitment to pro-democracy reform. I've been disappointed personally that a coherent, integrated effort to save our politics from this creeping corporatocracy and plutocracy did not emerge after the 2012 elections with the strength that I hoped that it would. We went immediately on to substantive issues, but the progressive communities have got to come together and save our politics. We won't win unless we reclaim the systems of democracy. And part of that has got to be to get busy out in the grassroots, to build not only a powerful base in the communities, in neighborhoods, grassroots around the country, but to bring this together and link it to national objectives. And I can tell you that my environmental tribe for 40 years now has been focused overwhelmingly sort of inside the Beltway work. There have been a lot of local groups, but the big national groups have gone right into the Beltway to do the litigating and the lobbying and have lost this, did not go into politics, did not go into grassroots organizing, and I think it's proven quite costly. Lastly, the eighth area where I think we can, where we need to promote transformative change is this rebirth of protest and direct action. I was Bill McKibben's cellmate for 3 days, and I've been trying to, I see him coming now, and I sort of hide. But we will, this summer, there will be opportunities for you. There are opportunities at a big power plant in Massachusetts. It starts with a B. Yes, there will be arrest-ready demonstrations right there for you. And there are many other sites around the country, McKibben and 350.org and others, are organizing what they call Summer Heat. And the great thing that I think that this campaign, that Bill has been at the center of, and I give him so much credit as a leader, the great thing that they have done is to take this generalized feeling about the climate issue that we're all guilty, we drive, we heat our houses, and say, no, there are some real villains in the climate story. And they are the executives of the big fossil fuel companies that are doing everything they can to sell as much of that stuff as possible, doing everything they can to prevent the folks in Washington from doing anything to even slow them up, much less stop them, which is basically what we need to do by mid-century, and are doing it, many of them, most of them, I would say, knowing full well that they're doing incalculable damage to the planet and not caring. And so it's time. It's time for a rebirth of protests and demonstrations and marches and nonviolent civil disobedience. So those, to me, are sort of eight touchstones, eight pressure points, eight ways of which we have got to move if we want to advance these various transitions. And again, we can ask ourselves, how far along are we? For example, in bringing the future into the present at the community level, as we have seen here over the last 2 days, and many of you do in your daily lives, that is moving ahead, I would say, is the best thing happening in our country. And it's very positive. But the indicators, you know, you got to think, well, maybe we are getting close to dethroning GDP. But on other things like our growth fetish, we are nowhere near getting that done, getting beyond that growth fetish. And so there are different, you know, we're at different places on these different indicators. And it's a good exercise to ask yourself, to go down a list like this and ask yourself, well, you know, where are we? How far along are we? What can we do to advance the cause? In each of those dozen areas that I listed in the first part of the talk, we know a lot about what needs to be done. It is not like we don't know how to move forward. We may not know all the things, and we don't know how it will all fit together, but they are, you know, libraries are full of proposals for advancing each of those dozen areas of change that I listed for you at the outset. So I think in the end, it all comes down to us, to the American people. And the question is there. Do we still have it in us to use our freedom, to use our democracy in powerful ways to create a new reborn America? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you so much, Gus, for that. And for being part of helping change the narrative and helping us tell the new story. I think Gus has been one of our storytellers, helping us dethrone the fetish of the growth model. And that is a challenging conversation, and he is engaging with people on that all the time. I wanted to just mention, I'm very excited because Gus's remarks, I think, perfectly set up Tina Clark's presentation. When he was talking about new indicators, I wanted to mention that in the neighborhood where I live in Jamaica Plain, our transition town has a little resilience indicators project. Is Jenny Jones in the room? Is she there? There she is back there. Anyway, what Jenny and her committee have been doing is creating our own neighborhood indicators. I mean, we're looking at some of the bigger indicators, and I know people are doing this in other regions and in Vermont, but it's a very interesting process because it creates a way to measure our progress. How much of our calories are we producing in our urban neighborhood? How many jobs and livelihoods are created through that? And starting to say, what are our indicators for a healthy community? I also wanted to mention a couple weeks ago, there was a bright sunny morning out near Brayton Point Coal Plant outside Fall River, Massachusetts. And just as the energy, a giant ship came rolling in to unload yet another load of mountaintop removal coal from West Virginia, a small lobster boat blocked the pier. And the lobster boat was the Henry David T. And with a banner on it saying, coal is stupid. And kept the energy from docking. The Coast Guard, the police, everybody didn't know what to do. Finally, they said, you'll have to move your boat. And they said, well, we have this 200-pound anchor we dropped, and we can't find a way to pull it up. And so they stayed all day and blocked the shipment, and then at the end of the day, found a way to get the anchor up. And so we want you to invite you to come back to Brayton Point on July 27th and bring your canoe and kayak, and we want to see the Henry David T2 and the Henry David T3, and we're going to do a huge nautical blockade of the energy, and we're going to do a land protest as well. So in echoing Gus's, it's time to turn up the heat on the fossil fuel industry. So, come on up. So I think Tina Clark, and I'm curious, I want to ask a question. Tina Clark is somebody who has devoted her life, particularly the last 10 years here in New England, to helping build this global transition movement. And I'm curious how many people have had Tina come to your community or give a presentation or have been touched by Tina's work. Okay, there's a lot of people here in this room who know Tina. And I think that's important. In our neighborhood in Jamaica Plain, we had Tina came and did a community forum on transition, and we had a packed house, and then she led a weekend-long training of trainers to help us launch our transition community. That is what she's been doing. But I wanted to say she is also holding the torch for some of the lessons of this global transition movement that have come out of England, and she's going to talk about that. But one of the great things about the transition movement is recognizing that there are different frameworks and different language. There's people use different phrases, slow living and the new economy, transition, resilience. But there is a convergence in our language, and we don't have a lot of time to kind of get wordsmithy. This is an opportunity. We want to build community resilience from the bottom up in a deep and fundamental way. That's what we know is at the core of this transformation we need to be part of. And she's one of the people who's really held that and articulated that. Tina has, in the program, it says she's a certified transition trainer in Massachusetts. That is a great underestimation of her role. She is a global transition trainer. She has worked in Mexico and Nova Scotia. She's done 44 weekend institutes to help start transition towns in the Northeast and around the US. She's been worked with over 200 transition communities in her efforts. So please welcome and show gratitude to Tina for the work that she's done over these years.
I'm amazed how many of you have been to my trainings and still came to hear this talk. So 2 years ago, I was sitting in the back when the first, I've done transition workshops at every Slow Living Summit, and I had just 6 months earlier been in Jamaica Plain and trained the whole IPS staff, and the director of IPS was on the stage and gave an amazing transition talk, and I thought, wow, those guys work quick. They got it through their whole organization in a matter of months. But that's what we all saw in 2006, 7, 8, 9. The transition movement moved through our country, and it shifted all of us in the environmental movement from complaining about SUVs to talking about local food. And what a great change that was. And of course, many of you have been doing transition-like activities, and you know, we often find that people say, well, I don't want to, you know, be a part of a new thing. I've been doing this for 30 years or 50 years. And that's exactly right. And in fact, when the transition movement came to the U.S., The folks in the UK were kind of alarmed that it was so popular that people were starting to say, this is the answer. This is the answer to everything. And so the transition folks in the UK came up with what they call the cheerful disclaimer. And the cheerful disclaimer is, we're just a bunch of neighbors in our town in Totnes in the UK. We're not pretending to have the answer. We're interested in being in a network with all of you. And together, maybe we can come up with some good project ideas. So this movement is really a core, a very humble one, and is quite concerned that people would say, you know, this is the answer. Fortunately, in the U.S., we're way too independent-minded to ever join somebody else's thing, so that hasn't been a big problem. And when I started doing transition talks in Western Mass, in 7 months, we had 25 transition initiatives start in Western Mass, and it just took off like lightning. And then you know, a couple of groups came along and said, well, really, we're going to manage transition, and we're going to control it, and gradually it all kind of died because the hierarchy came in and sort of told people how they should think about it. Transition is really, it's all bottom up. It's, you know, you don't have to do anything other than what you think works in your community. It's totally decentralized in decision making. And that's the beauty, because as indigenous people have known for many thousands of years, each place is unique, and each community and each religious system, to help us understand how to get along in our unique place, the world's religions and spiritual and ideological traditions have historically been stories and characterizations of how to live in that place. If you lived in the desert, you didn't know how to live in the mountains. And so there were different myths and stories and religions and cultural practices. And so I see transition, in one sense, as a process for us to become indigenous again, to really become rooted in place with the people who've happened to land in that place with us. And so it's both incredibly exciting to have a process that works with our human nature and helps us get back to truly stable, happy, sustainable ways of being. And it's also painful, because we've gotten excited about burning so much fossil fuel. It's been, as Rob Hopkins says, a wild joyride, and it's hard to let go of some of our addictions and our ways of living. So I wanted to share with you just a little bit about this movement, how it approaches this colossal challenge of change. And also from an American perspective, just one perspective, I don't pretend to speak for the whole transition movement in this country or even in my own town of Amherst, that it's really an invitation to conversation and to exploration. And therein lies its strength and beauty, that we have conversations with our neighbors instead of thinking we have the answer of what they should do and how they should change. So the Transition Network is our big playground of where we can come together and share ideas. And you'll go there and you'll see that a lot of Americans have not signed up their initiatives. Many of them have just folded transition concepts into their work. In fact, I've had the most harrowing, competitive, aggressive reactions of my entire 33-year political career while doing transition, the most mild and friendly approach ever, where people get very threatened. There's a lot of competitive things that go on, and it can be extremely painful. But I've now come to see that it is just part of our challenge in this country to move from our individualism, as Gus was saying, to deep cooperation and deep community. And it's very hard for us, because we've been so rewarded and trained and conditioned to take control, to manage, to think we know better, to be in charge, to have the answers, to find the right language that we're going to convince everybody with our perfect language, and to shift from being in charge and to knowing the answers to being a neighbor and being in conversation and exploration is a really difficult thing to do. And it's also hard to give up some of our heart connections and the people we'd really rather spend time with, to have to deal with the people who live next door. I lived in the first co-housing community on the East Coast, and we used to joke, like, why is it that all the people you really like wouldn't move into co-housing with you, and all the people that you can't stand now, you have to live next door to? And it's just that great irony and that challenge. When Sophie and Naresh, the two international trainers, came over in 2010, and we did a big tour around Vermont and Western Mass and other parts of the East Coast. And I had told them before they came about some of the challenges I was facing, hoping, even though they told me about the cheerful disclaimer and had told me they wanted to learn community organizing from me, and I said, really? I don't think I have anything much to teach you all. I was still looking to them to provide answers. And so I described some of the challenges, and they thought I was being a little bit, you know, like negative thinking or something. And then they came over, and after 10 days they said, Tina, we understand what you're saying, and we don't know how to help you. And at that point I said, it's okay. I kind of like America overall. And these are good people. So the transition movement is really just, you can just not worry about having to join anything. It's just a network of people all over the world who want to share creative ideas and are eager to hear yours. And I guarantee if you sign up with a project that you're doing, whether you call it transition or not, you'll get somebody from Hungary or India or Brazil or New Zealand or Japan writing back to you and saying, oh, that's a great idea, we're going to try it in our town. And it's just such a blast. Okay, so Transition US is our hub of connection in the US. And so these two provide lots of opportunities to get resources and support and to get all kinds of connections with other groups. So this is a finicky thing here. Let's see if we can find that spot. So in the transition movement in the US, oh, I've got my help up there. That's all right. I'll just mess with it. See if I can do it. It took off like lightning. I mean, they were just doing projects. Todd Ness, which is down here in Devon, just started working together to try to transition the town. And soon, within a few months, 83 other towns were imitating them, and then it ballooned. And when I was there in 2009, there were 1,000 communities that were using the transition model in some form. And it was spreading across the world. It's now in 35 countries. Yeah, thank you very much. In the US, it spread really quickly. I remember when I spoke in Ithaca, and it, with 3 days' notice, you know, 18 people showed up, and then the room blossomed to 40. And that was happening all over the East Coast in 2009, 2010. And it just completely transformed people's thinking. And you can hear it. The Slow Living Summit is all this kind of language. The idea behind the movement was that we're very dependent. And this is dependency is an excellent word to use with the whole society. I mean, folks who hate government don't like people being dependent on government handouts. People don't like being dependent on the Middle East for oil. People don't like being dependent on anyone else and anyone else controlling them. And so you can use this dependency language to cut across the political barriers. And the dependency on oil is something everyone agrees to. Nixon's been talking about it, you know, and Nixon talked about it way back, and everyone else since. The petroleum interval, you know, we talk about peak oil, many of you are familiar with that. And some of you know about the warnings in the business industry that have been coming out for a number of years now. This is Lloyd's, the giant insurance conglomerate in 200 countries. The world is facing a period of deep uncertainty over the decline, how the decline will happen in fossil fuels. $200 a barrel oil by 2020, oil supply crunch and price spike, we should be transitioning to a low-carbon economy. So when we talk about this low-carbon world, we have lots of companies, the Chamber of Commerce, the Bush administration, et cetera. And then we go on to make the point that it's not just the oil that we're going to extract, it's how much oil it takes to get that oil, and how we're going to see a more rapid decline in cheap energy, especially with conventional oil, the easy stuff to get out of the ground. And so looking at the costs to society, economic costs, the energy costs, the health and the environmental costs, how much water are we going to trash, how much land are we going to destroy to get that last drop of oil. Even if you don't talk about the climate crisis, just the harrowing impacts on life and wildlife and humans' health. Peak coal, you know, for those who think we can still do coal gasification, the idea that we're going to be able to find some other substitute. Methane hydrates are our big, you know, the big grab, simple solution now. But this is a chart showing the same kind of classic curve of, you know, growth and decline in coal supplies. And then you know, we finally are getting all these international agencies like the OECD and the International Energy Agency that our conventional oil actually has peaked already, and all these other, you know, types of fossil fuels. So here's the unconventional oil, you know, that's the Alberta tar sands, natural gas, the hydrofracking, crude oil. This is my favorite category, fields yet to be found. Notice how it makes everything okay here. Crude oil fields yet to be developed. This is like the deep water horizon. This is, you know, the Arctic oil. All the things that are going to completely trash our environment. So, you know, transition has helped us get the ideas of peak oil combined with the climate crisis. James Hansen saying, you know, we only have a handful of years to turn this trajectory. Economic downturn put us in a better, you know, in the right way. We need room for the energy, the climate crisis, but it's not been helping us in other dimensions in terms of poverty. And so then you're all familiar with runaway global warming, that it's not about our children and our grandchildren, it's about us. It's the tornadoes happening right now. It's all these switches that we're flipping, and we don't have time. So I spent my career in public policy advocacy, working, you know, directing Greenpeace USA, Citizen Action Network nationally, running a national training program with 17 faith denominations, Catholic, Protestant, Jewish, historic black churches, Muslim. We worked together on a whole range of policy issues in Oklahoma and Indiana and Pennsylvania and conservative places, and we were able to build coalitions. And I was doing climate education with labor leaders and national faith leaders with Bill McKibben, and I got arrested with him in the year 2000, so we all have our jail time experience with Bill. And so here I am doing all this public policy work, climate education, getting paid to do it, professional activism, right? And last year, I'm sitting in the back of this hall with Bill McKibben after he gave his talk, and I said, this is really hilarious. 5 years ago, you were writing a book about localizing economies, and I was doing, you know, political action and organizing for power to change corporate power, and now I'm organizing local community economy and community resilience, and you're getting arrested and doing political advocacy. And he looked at me and basically was teasing me and said, so why aren't you coming back to the advocacy movement? And the answer is, I am so freaked out about how we have no time left, that we have no time to educate. I spent my 20 years, I've been in the environmental movement, and before that in the anti-nuclear and the apartheid movement, human rights movement. We don't have time to change the thinking of everybody. We've got to figure out what maximally works and get the most people doing the right thing as fast as possible. And actually, the way that human beings work, when we have relationships and when we do activities that shift, then we come up with the rationalizations. So if you've studied how human shifts happen, you have to have emotional and social support first, especially in a society like ours where people are so isolated and individual. And you have to first nurture them and support them. I mean, there are a few crazy people like us. You know, we love ideas, we buy books, we love to come to conferences and hear new ideas, and we're sort of those innovators and the creative thinkers. But most people are, and we could do a whole analysis of this, and in the transition training we do, to look at what motivates people, what the barriers are for them, and how does political change actually occur? How do you get the 25, 30, 35% that you need to really push through, like the populist movement 100 years ago, taking back the power from the robber barons? How do you get that level of engagement? And it has to be through relationships. And now we've got the corporate media that's propagandizing and dominating people's consciousness and filling them with all the material things and all the vacations and the plane trips and the buying things, and your kids, you know, have to be happy in this certain way that materialism requires. And we're not there for each other as neighbors. We don't even like our neighbors. We don't want to hear their opinions. They're driving their SUVs around, you know. We don't want to be bothered. And that problem is the real reason that we're not winning in this country, because we have so much creative expertise. We have so many innovative people. The folks in the UK, they look at us and they say, teach us about diversity. Teach us about collaboration, you know, across race and class. Teach us about how to be creative and unloose our bonds of society and be able to be flexible and change our lives. We're good at that in this country, but as Gus said, and you really put your finger on it, We don't work well. Those who understand and critique have a hard time working together. I submit to you that the transition movement, the transition is already happening. The resilience movement is already moving out beyond us. It's already, and we can help make it move much more quickly by deciding to embrace the inner transition approach, or you call it, or consciousness approach that people are describing, but the real heartfelt connections where we spend time in conversation with our neighbors rather than trying to get them to adopt a particular program or particular language or to do a thing that we think. We join with them in creative evolution. And in your community, you will find how to get people involved by listening, by becoming friends with people, by crossing the boundaries and respecting, and especially because you probably have more academic credentials and more confidence and more knowledge than most of the people in your community, except for Jamaica Plain and Cambridge and a few places, and Brattleboro and a few places in Vermont. But many of you have so much more information. And so if you put that information in the back seat and you put your heart in the front seat to make friends and have fun and be curious and find out where are the networks of communication, the community is already there to a large extent. And where it's not there, it's people who are broken and isolated and need your friendship and your respect. And if you take that approach of listening and building and creating together, you'll find this whole process will unfold in ways that you absolutely didn't expect. And you'll find that what you thought was going to work never went anywhere. But these other relationships and connections. And that's why transition is a team sport. It's about collaboration. It's about us really deeply caring about each other's gifts. So I leave you with one question. How might you support all the people that you love in your community to give their gifts in a more courageous way, to be more connected in community in fun ways and in joyful ways? And what is the gift that you most want to give? What is your own path of unfolding? And what is the courage and the support that you'd like to receive in friendship from others to help you give that gift so that you find a team of people who together are supporting each other to care about your community, to support your community members in giving their gifts, and each of you supporting each other in your own unfolding to become as courageous and loving and compassionate and having as much fun as possible in this time of crisis. So thank you very much.
We're going to accept that offer of 10 additional minutes so that we can hear from questions and comments. So I think we have some microphones. Is that, we have some? While I mention that, I want to mention that there are a couple of more of these transition discussions, and there's a flyer in the back that has all the events that are happening today and on Saturday related to this, these transition communities getting together. And one of the things that is coming out of this is people are visiting each other's communities. So I want to invite you to come to Jamaica Plain if you ever are in Boston. Come on a Saturday to see some of the projects that are underway, the farmers market, the local food efforts, the petty taxi cooperative that's trying to start up, and just see, because we're, you know, when I went to Portland and I visited some of your communities, it's been a fabulous way to learn about the very concrete, practical projects that Tina and the transition movement have inspired. Question. Any questions from the audience? And we have one here. We have a microphone here. Okay, yeah. Wondering if we could trouble you to come and people have a question, come and come down, and we'll have a portable, instead of moving the mic around, we'll have a stationary, two stationary mics here, right? Is that right? So here's one here. Feel free to stand up and come down. If you're stuck in the middle of the aisle, your neighbors will understand. So right here, yeah.
Okay, first of all, I'm coming at this from the standpoint of...
eat your microphone, as they say.
Right, okay. And I'm a from political activism about climate change. And I have agreed for years that the big organizations really needed to get out and do grassroots organizing and shaking things up with demonstrations. I'm concerned. I came here with the feeling of a disconnect between transition communities and the political activism around this, and it shouldn't be. This is a disconnect that needs some connecting. And I'm concerned, and particularly with what I heard from Tina, that there's going to be a sense that the transition communities will get rid of the need for the political part of this. And frankly, the issue has a lot to do with communities as well as physics and chemistry. The problem for getting it done quickly enough, though, is fundamentally political, because while the transition communities are extremely important, the political part of this is going to be absolutely necessary.
Tina and Gus, if either of you have a thought here.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I was hoping that by describing my 30 years as a political advocate and my activism still on that, that I would help people understand we need both and. My, you know, all of you who are willing to get arrested, please go get arrested. We need you to. We need people to be very, very politically active in ways. And so when I talk about what is the gift that you want to give, what is your passion, what do you feel called to do? How can you become more courageous in this time of absolute crisis that we have so little time to shift things? So please give your passion in whatever way. What I'm trying to say is that we have such an intense propaganda system from the corporate media that when I, you know, 1975, we had 5,000 media businesses in this country. Now we have 7 that own over 93% of all of the print, you know, radio, television, media, internet, etc. So we're in an absolute period of propaganda, intense misinformation. And what we know is that when you are, and those of you who've done political campaigning, gone door to door, you know this, and work in states that are swing or conservative, you know that it's extremely important to reach people through their connections, their relationships. That there's about a third of the population that gets their ideas from their priest, their neighbor, their family member, somebody they work with. And so if you want to fly under the radar and get the truth out, You have to work through relational communication lines, and we don't have the money to take on, you know, corporate propaganda system at the media level. So what I'm saying is that by those of you who are passionate and drawn to having to building community in your life for your own reasons or for a desire to change attitudes in your own town so you can shift the politics in your own town, or because you want to, you know, do this kind of transition work because it's what gives you passion, I was trying to help you be more effective, that focusing on relationships first instead of your message, focusing on the connection, the human connection of friendship and neighborliness instead of trying to persuade somebody to join your way of thinking, is a much more effective way of connecting. So that's the only point I'm making.
Nobody can hear. Yeah, I think nobody can hear you. So, yeah. And the, Gandhi used to say you need to have constructive program, which was sort of the village economics, and the direct action, and that social change had both elements of those movements. And I know in our neighborhood, the transition organizing has given rise to a new constituencies of people who can get involved in more of a political action. Gus had a quick response to this thought as well, and then we'll go to that microphone there.
Well, I think that, I don't know whether this is good news or bad news, but if I had to predict, I will make a prediction. I think over the next maximum, over the next two, maximum three summers and falls, the climate impacts are going to be so severe. They already are, but they're going to get worse. And it's so severe that it's going to fuel a huge outcry in the country, so loud that even Washington is going to have to respond. And, you know, I mentioned that one of the great things that that my friend Bill McKibben has done, and 350.org, is to focus on, you know, to pinpoint the real villainry in the climate story. You know, a movement requires both villains and victims. And what we are seeing now is not just an intellectual concern about the climate issue, an anticipation of concern, but the rise of vast numbers of climate victims out there who can be turned into climate heroes, and many will become climate heroes. And I think if you add that to the already existing concern about mountaintop removal and fly ash and coal washing waste and power plants and fracking and offshore in the Arctic and in the deep Gulf and on, you're gonna see the rise of, we will see the rise of a powerful anti-fossil fuel movement in the coming along very quickly.
Thank you. Can you introduce yourself too?
Okay, my name is Judy Schwartz, and Tina touched on this, but I still think it's worth bringing up, and heck, I was already standing up here. I'm a journalist, and it's been very painful to see that my profession is, in many ways, acting as a barrier to change, in a sense, particularly in the economic side. And it's subtle. It's not just corporate media, it's also public media and sometimes independent media about how our challenges are framed. And it's just so frustrating. And just, I would just invite everybody to ask the right questions of the media and to see if you have any comments about how we can make that change happen, because so many people look to the media for how to understand our situation.
Yeah, well said. I was sitting on my father was ill, and I've been trying not to fly since 2006, and I have two exceptions, when my employer would force me and when my father was ill. So I was on a plane when my father went in the hospital last December, and I sat next to a beautiful, wonderful farm couple from Nebraska whose farm had withered and gone into complete drought. And it was amazing because these are the kind of people I grew up with. My mother is from a farm in Indiana, and this is like the backbone of the type of people I know growing up in Kansas. And they said, well, Obama is Muslim. And they didn't know anything about global warming. And you know, we will look at the political analysis and the polls in a lot of the swing states, because I always think politically, even if it sounds like I'm not. If you look at the swing states, you see that there are lots and lots of people who are under the pressure of massive misinformation, and they're in some of the key states that we need to, you know, to change votes in Congress. And so it's one of those. I'm also hopeful, like Gus said, that we've got a strong enough movement that we can override some of that we've got a movement building that's going to politically be powerful. But I share your concern about the media, the self-censorship within the media, that there are lots of people who are very dug in their political way of behaving. And even if they become aware of the climate crisis, they may still vote the wrong ways, and we're not going to be able to get the policy change and rein in corporate power. So that's where it's a both and. My reason for doing transition is ultimately very politically strategic, that I have all these conservative relatives and friends, and I've worked in all these conservative states, and we can get them on our side to do the right things without requiring them to change their values or their consciousness or their belief system, just by talking to them in ways that matter. And transition gives us a tool for doing that. So that's why I'm excited about it, and I spend my time promoting it.
We have time for one more pithy question and two pithy answers. Does that sound all right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whoa, sorry.
I'm sorry. We'll do one question here then. I'm sorry for everybody. I didn't see you.
Hi, I'm Lee Marinoff. We are creating a community here in West Townsend. The problem is, and this is what I'd really like to see if we can't piggyback with you, Tina. Once you start a community and you apply for 501c3 status, you all of a sudden can't be a political activist. through your community. And could somebody guide us? Could we start a new arm of Transition Town so that we could sign up 100,000 communities around the world that are doing this, and then we could go to Congress. We can go to the Senate. So if you guys want to do that, I could get us the connections in there, and I'm in, if you're in. Could we move this forward so we're not here again next year, but we take another day and we figure this out?
Great.
You know, I encourage everybody to join 350.org.
Okay.
You know, we've got the groups out there, or Greenpeace.
A 501c3 can do a lot of lobbying. They don't have, you can lobby, it's the electioneering that you've got to worry about.
20%.
Yeah. Thank you all for your attention, and let's give Tina and Gus a round of applause. Thank you.